So good morning, everybody. This is a new seminar from the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía in Granada in Spain. And today we will have the seminar given by Dr. José Miguel Rodríguez Espinoza from Instituto de Astrofísica de Canarias in Spain also. And he will talk about the, is the Bremer Deep Field ionized at sit equals 7? So, José Miguel Rodríguez Espinoza is a research in the Instituto de Astrofísica in Canary Island. He finished his PhD in 1984 in Universidad Complutense de Madrid, and then he moved to United States, and he received another PhD in the University of California in San Diego in 1985. He has more than 100 papers in review journals, and he was one of the principal investigators of one of the first consolidating ingenio in 2010. He was the scientific director of the Gran Telescopio de Canarias, the GTC. And then he started here his activity in active galaxies, and then he moved to the field of researcher in the early universe. Thank you very much, José Miguel, for giving us this seminar, and the floor is yours.
You're very welcome. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay. So people know that the universe is reionized. It's reionized because it was ionized at the very beginning. But the reionization we are talking about was produced normally by population three stars or starburst galaxies. And it occurs through ionized bubbles that merge to each other, thus getting bigger, and finally completing reionization by a redshift of about 6. So the question is, where are these bubbles? Can we find those? Some of these bubbles? Well, I worked before in the ALBA project, in which we found an ionized bubble at the redshift of 6.5. And while I was working on that ionized bubble, I decided to study the Bremer Deep Field because Castellano tried to find an ionized bubble, but he couldn't find that ionized bubble. And I'll explain you why. Now, recently, there are many ionized bubbles that has been discovered, and these people are using an equation or a graph done by Yajima 2020, in which the radius of the bubble is proportional to the luminosity of Lyman alpha. And I explain why this method works later on. By the way, Yajima uses a 20% Lyman continuum scale fraction in his code. Anyway, the Bremer Deep Field was discovered by Bremer, although Bremer was the second in the paper that, in the discovery paper. And Vansella, in particular, discovered two Lyman alpha sources in this field. Later on, Castellano, in 2018, discovered one more Lyman alpha emitters in this field. However, they also discovered 14 Lyman break galaxies. But the pointings for the discovery were guided by the Lyman alpha sources discovered by Vancella. So you can see here that there is one image. Let me get rid of this thing. There is group two, I should have written here, and group one. These are the two original Lyman alpha emitters, and then Castellano discovered this one, and these are the Lyman break galaxies. The others in blue are the Lyman break galaxies. So the BDF is full of emission, it's full of emitting sources, starboard galaxies in general. And they particularize on these two sources originally discovered. And you can see it's full of gas and full of star forming galaxies. However, they claim that a bubble could be formed only until about 500 million years of forming stars, and only if the scale fraction was of the order of 60%, which is very large by all standards. In any case, they claim that the overdensity in the field was between 3 and 4, and we took 3.5. In any case, this is the paper by Castellano. And as you can see that these objects, for instance, can reach the mark. This is a mark at 1.1 proper megaparsec, which is the size of a bubble that allows the Lyman alpha photons to escape. And that is because when they reach the border, they are reshifted in such a way that they can freely escape through the neutral interstellar medium that is outside the bubble, the ionized bubble. Even summing two sources that are very close together, you can see that only after 500 years, a million years, excuse me, or even 200, if you allow for a larger scale fraction, they can form an ionized bubble that is ionized. In any case, what they didn't do is they didn't consider the LBGs. The Lyman break galaxies have an ultraviolet continuum, which is also emitting ionizing photons. And they did not consider this. And they didn't consider any low luminosity sources. And the low luminosity sources, people think that are the most important factor in rejuvenating the universe. So we did consider all these sources. And we took the three LIES, Lyman emitting sources, the Lyman break galaxies, and the low luminosity sources that I obtained from a paper by Bowens, in which he gave a surface density of sources. And simply multiplying by the surface of the observation, I could get the number of low luminosity sources. So these are the three Lyman alpha emitters. I'm not going to discuss anything about this. And this is a table where I show the three labels. These two belong to group one, and this alone belong to group two. So what I did is, since they gave the fluxes of Lyman alpha and the equivalent width, I obtained from Sobral and Mati the equivalent width, and I computed not only the Lyman alpha observed, but the intrinsic Lyman alpha. And from the intrinsic Lyman alpha, I got the number of ionizing continuum photons, which is here. Now, regarding the Lyman break sources, what they did, what they wrote in their paper was the magnitudes in AB. So I derived the number of continuum ionizing photons, essentially converting the AB magnitude to a flux at 1320, which is the filter that they use for discovery, and then converting this to a luminosity at 1500 angstrom, and from this I can get the number of ionizing continuum photons. Through this equation, from the Lyman alpha luminosity, I get the number of continuum ionizing photons. About the low luminosity sources, the same. Essentially, I have here the surface density in the per arm minute square. I know the surface of each of the two groups. One is 3.94 and 3.82. And I corrected for the overdensity, which is 3.5, as I mentioned before. And then the number of sources is here. And I did the same. I got their magnitude in the range, because the Bowens gave a range of magnitudes. So from the magnitude in the middle of the range, I got the flux at 1320, the luminosity at 1500, and the number of ionizing photon, or continuum ionizing photon in group one and in group two. As you can see, these are larger than what we saw before. So putting everything together, you have the lies in group one. There are two, and for this reason, this is a bit bigger. The mid luminosity and the low luminosity sources. So as for the lies, I'm saying that this is larger than this. And again here, and this is because we still don't know the escape fraction of Lyman continuum photons, that we need to get the right number of continuum ionizing continuum photons for the lies. So, regarding emissivities, the emissivities have been derived from the AMIGA model, who was published by Eduardo Salvador Solé in 2017. The AMIGA model allows for single and double reionisation, and this is seen here in this graph. Single reionisation is the red and double is the green. And the emissivities from this figure are 0.26, 10 to the 51 per second per megaparsec cubic for single reionization, and 0.36, 10 to the 51 per second per megaparsec cube for double reionization. These emissivities need to be multiplied by the overdensity factor and the ionization status of the medium, which at redshift 7 is of the order of 0.7. So the number of photons required for reionizing the volumes of group one, which is this volume, and group two, which is this volume, we multiply those emissivities by the volumes. So finally, we compare the number of photons required to reionize group one and group two with the number of photons available from the sources in the BDF. There is an ingredient missing, which is the scale fraction of Lyman continuum. We get this value solving this equation. So in this equation, we have the number of ionizing continuum photons from the LBGs, the medium and low luminosity LBGs, the lies, which is divided by one minus the scale fraction of Lyman continuum photons. And we multiply that by the scale fraction of Lyman continuum photon, and we equate it to the minimum number of ionizing continuum photons that is required for ionizing the bubble. So this equation can be solved very easily. And at the end, we have that not only the number of photons that are available is larger than this, but the scale fraction is derived using this strategy. So these are scale fractions that are fairly small in agreement with recent literature. These values that produce a bubble that fills the volume of either groups, those are the values. In increasing the value of the scale fraction, we increase the volume of the ionized bubble. So I mentioned at the beginning that Yajima made a model in which he used he found a correlation between the radius of the H2 region that produces the bubble with the Lyman alpha emission, with the luminosity of the Lyman alpha emission. And people are using this model to calculate the radius of ionized bubble. So I said, let me explain this. Why is this happening? So we started with a well-known expression given by Singh and Hyman in 2000, in which they derive the differential with respect to time of the cube of the radius of the bubble. And essentially, this equation has three terms. One is the expansion of the universe, of the cosmological expansion, the ionization part, and the recombination part of the equation. So we started trying to integrate this equation to derive the radius of an ionized bubble without success, I have to tell. And the reason for that is because we need to use volumes, commoving volumes, instead of the radius of the bubble. So we need to solve the equation in commoving coordinates. And here you have the commoving volume, which is the radius of Earth's sphere divided by the scale factor of the universe. Okay? Well, so the derivative of the volume is equal to this, which is this part and this part. Then multiplying the Sen and Hyman equation by 3 times the scale factor cube of the universe divided by 4 pi, and making the variation in the comoving volume of the bubble equal to zero, we get this equation. From this equation, we can derive the radius, which is this one here. Now, note that in this equation is actually the typical equation for the, excuse me, for the radius of a Strongren sphere that you can see in books by Osterbrock or Spitzer, whatever, or Lyman-Spitzer, whatever. Now, the interesting thing about this equation is that you can allow for overdensities just multiplying this density, this is the hydrogen density, by the overdensity. And you can allow for scale fraction by multiplying the number of ionizing photons by one minus the scale fraction of Lyman continuum photons. So this is a very versatile equation that can be used in many cases. As I said before, this is the radius of a Strongren sphere. And of course, this gives you the proper radii. To get comoving radii, we divide by A, and that's it. And I can give you some examples. For instance, the collection of sources in WHO 2021, this is in Nature Astronomy, you can see the radius derived by WHO and those derived by us. You can see that they agree pretty well. There are, at times, there are some outliers. For instance, this WHO measured 12, we measure 5, but other than that, the rest of the number are pretty reasonable. Another example is June 2020, in which, again, the number computed by June using the Yajima expression are these, and our number are very similar. Very similar. So what about protocluster? Because the sources that you could see here, these are individual Lyman alpha emitters, and these also are individual Lyman alpha emitters. So this is essentially the radius of each one of the Lyman alpha sources. And indeed, Yajima, in his paper, he said that it applies only to single sources. So protoclusters are not foreseen in the Yajima. What about in our case, the BDF? Of course, the BDF is a protocluster, and we derive before an FSK of 0.11, making an average between group one and group two. In this case, the number of ionizing continuum photons available, in this case, with the number of ionizing continuum photons available, the volume derived are 2400 and 2200 comoving megaparsec cube for group one and group two, respectively, which is enough to cover not only group one and group two, but the whole extent of the BDF. So in our case, we can apply the expression that we obtain, this expression for protocluster in the same way that we apply this equation to individual sources. The question is, if we don't have the scale fraction of Lyman continuum photons. It doesn't matter because essentially, if you have the entire population of ionizing continuum photons, what you do is you enlarge the bubble. So why does the Yajima model work? It's very easy. There is a direct relation between the number of ionizing continuum photons and the luminosity of Lyman alpha, and which is this expression that you see here, which I wrote it before. In this equation, Q is the number of ionizing continuum photons per second, and this is Lyman alpha, and this is scale factor. The difference between Yajima model and ours is that we can apply it to protoclusters. Indeed, Dayal, Pratica Dayal in 2019 thought that protoclusters were the building blocks of reionization. So most big bubbles are produced by protocluster instead of individual sources. And this is my summary. We have found a large ionized bubble in the BDF. The ionizing photons required have been provided by three types of sources: Lyman emitting sources, medium luminosity LBGs, Lyman bright galaxies, and low luminosity Lyman bright galaxies. We have derived also the scale fraction of Lyman continuum photons required that is relatively small in line with many papers in the literature. We also note that the low luminosity galaxies are the stronger contributors to provide ionizing photons to ionize this bubble. This is in agreement with current reionisation scenarios. And probably you know that I'm going to move to the IAA in brief. And as we discover and characterize yet another bubble in the Alba Deep Field, I would like to get in touch with the IAA radio people to use LOFAR to check whether this bubble could be seen in the 21 centimeter hydrogen line. Indeed, the bubble do not produce the line, the 21 centimeter hydrogen line, but the outside of the bubble does produce the 21 centimeter hydrogen line. So we could measure the extent of the bubble using 21 centimeter with low far. Preliminary calculations suggest they could be seen and their sizes the limit. So I will be moving to the IAA by mid-June. Thanks very much. And I open for questions.
Thank you very much, José Miguel. And please, now the talk is open for questions. And to do that, raise your hand, or maybe we can start with Cassiana, but she opened the micro.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't know the procedure.
Okay. So if you want to make a question to everybody, just raise your hand and I will let you open the micro to do so. Pepe?
Thank you, René. I was unable to find my hand to raise in this device. Well, thank you, José Miguel. This is very, very interesting talk. And as you know, we are very much interested in this kind of research. And I have a question for, in relation to it's related to the last point you mentioned, but in relation to the bubbles, it's the boundaries of the bubble, are these bubbles, so are ionization bounded? So there is there a, enough, I presume, is there enough hydrogen for the bubble to be built, isn't it? So there are no holes, something like that, around the protoclusters in each one?
They are indeed ionization bounded. The bubbles are as large as the ionizing continuum photons allow. So mm-hmm. you are right.
So there are no tunnels or this kind of things, though, like holes or has these kind of things?
That I don't know. But essentially, in for individual sources, I think there are no holes. For protocluster, there might be. There might be, especially in region where the protocluster is less dense, there might be a hole. I imagine. I haven't thought of that.
Very interesting. So to connect with the structure, a large scale structure, this kind of thing.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. So another question was in relation to the LIES, the Lyman alpha emitters. This maybe I missed this part of the talk, but is there a sort of a scaling relation with the LIES and the amount of the size of the bubbles? Is there any scaling relation or?
Well, you've seen the Yajima model. The size of the bubble is proportional to the luminosity of Lyman alpha, which is also proportional to the number of ionizing continuum photons. You've seen the relation between the Lyman alpha luminosity and the ionizing continuum photon.
Okay, so according to the luminosity function, then that's scaling. Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Jose.
Bye. You're welcome.
Any other question for José Miguel? Don't be shy.
I may have everybody.
Please do your question.
Confused.
Here is a question, Anchon.
Here I am. Okay. This is, first of all, a good opportunity to welcome José Miguel officially.
John, sorry. Your micro is very far from you.
Can you hear me now? Does it work?
More or less. Yeah.
Yeah. Can you follow me? Yeah.
You work very well here, René. We can hear you very well. The sound is very good.
Okay. Go on.
Sorry. Okay. Yeah. Now, this is what I wanted to say is this is a good opportunity to officially welcome José Miguel to the Institute, who will join in it in the middle of June, as he has mentioned. So welcome to the Institute. We are very happy to have you here. We'll have the new secretary of the IAU being working at the Institute. And we are, in fact, also because of the scientific collaborations we are also proposing, very happy that you joined the Institute. Okay, then welcome.
Thank you very much, Angel.
Yeah. And the second thing is what you have mentioned. We were the other day when you visited the IAEA, yes, talking about the possibilities of detecting these bubbles with LOFAR, making use not of the long baselines. And I hope we will be working on that. And it's probably, I think it sounds very, very plausible that we will be able to it will be possible to detect these bubbles. And I think it's something to work to study very carefully the sensitivity that is required and the configuration of the LOFAR interferometer. But I think it opens a good opportunity. Uh-huh. Okay, that's all.
I look forward to that.
Thank you, Anton. Another question for José Miguel? Okay, seeing none, thank you very much for this wonderful seminar, and hope we can see each other in a few days here in Granada. And welcome to the Institute.
Bye.